Welcome to the Billionaire Mindset, your 30-day journey to thinking like a billionaire. Now you can just watch this video, or if you want to sign up for the entire series for free and get the bonus PDF companion calendar, check the link in the description below. Today is day 6, and we're going to learn the environment for success habits of billionaires. Enjoy.
People don't always like you, and they're not always happy for you. And if you surround yourself with people who are not accustomed to your success, they become fearful, they become scared, because you are reflecting back something to them that they don't recognize. Now, they're not going to say, you know, I'm very fearful, because you're reflecting back to me something I don't recognize. They're going to say, you know what they're going to say? They're going to say, who she thinks she is? Who she thinks she is? That only happens when you are around people who do not mean and want and aspire to the best for you. People who want the best for you want you to be your best. So my greatest advice to you is to surround yourself with people who are going to fill your cup until your cup runneth over. So when people say you're so full of yourself, you can say, yeah.
One of the great challenges in this world is knowing enough about a subject to think you're right.
Yes, I'm full. I'm so full, my cup runneth over. and to know that once your cup runneth over, you cannot spend your life with your gallon size offerings, offering them to pint-sized people. You have got to surround yourself with gallon-sized people who can hang in the same company with you, so that you're not offering your gallons to those little pipes out there who can't hold it anyway.
You need a team around you to deliver a lot of idea. How do you choose your team? Based on what?
Well, I suppose honestly that it tends to be gut feel more than anything else. So when I interview somebody, my interview question is always the same.
It's what do you just, ask?
I said, tell me the story of your life and the decisions that you made along the way and why you made them. And then also tell me about some of the most difficult problems you worked on and how you solved them. And that question, I think, is very important, because the people that really solved the problem, they know exactly how they solved it. They know the little details. And the people that pretended to solve the problem, they can maybe go one level, and then they get stuck.
Elon, you've been compared to Henry Ford, Richard Branson, you know, Steve Jobs. Who do you compare yourself to?
I don't really compare myself to anyone. I mean, it's not. I mean, there's certain people that I admire from history that I think are, you know, I think are great. Sort of certainly many of the scientists and engineers and literary figures and so forth. I'm a big fan of Benjamin Franklin. You know, who's a scientist and sort of thinker. And yeah, I mean, he was the kind of guy who did what needed to be done. You know, so. Guys like that,
right.
Wouldn't say I compare myself in any way, but I certainly admire them.
We all get gifts. We get certain things in our life that are that we're very lucky about. And one of the most powerful ones is who your early role models are. You know,
it was your grandfather.
It was, yeah. In a big sense. My mom and dad, but my grandfather too. And you know, my mom had me when she was 17 years old, and she was still in high school in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and this is in 1964. I can assure you that being a pregnant teenager in high school was not cool in Albuquerque, New Mexico at that time. And it was difficult for her. My grandfather went to bat for her when they tried to kick her out of school, and you know, they're incredible. The gift I had is this incredible family.
You will move in the direction of the people that you associate with. It's important to associate with people that are better than yourself. And actually, the most important decision many of you make, not all of you, will be the spouse you choose.
Right.
You want to associate with people who are the kind of person you'd like to be. You'll move in that direction, and the most important person by far in that respect is your spouse. I can't overemphasize how important that is, and you're right. The friends you have, they will form you as you go through life, and make some good friends, keep them for the rest of your life, but have them be people that you admire as well as like them.
I was very lucky in life. If you tell me who your heroes are, I will make a pretty good prediction about what you're going to do. And I had the right heroes. I was very lucky in life, and my heroes never let me down, and started with my dad, and then I had others in business. And so I have had great teachers, some formal teachers, some that were just informal teachers, teachers by instinct or example. And if I hadn't had those, my life, I'm sure, would have been very different.
I always believe in, I love the You know, I love that thing of collaborating, you taking the best of what you do and someone taking the best of what you do, and you not robbing from what they do and they not robbing from what you do, and y'all bring the best of what you are to the table and you put it in this mix and you see what happens. You know, I love that part of creating. So there'll definitely be, you know, because I don't believe in those lines that people put up for music. You know, this is for this person, this is for that people. You know, this is rock, this is blues. I just believe good music, bad music, and, you know, put those two elements in the room and, you know, see what happens. Let the, you know, God, the universe, the movement, whatever happens in that room tonight, whatever happens, you know, make great music.
There's no doubt that you know, creating a board, having people like Dave Marquardt there who wasn't at the company, you know, and we were so overwrought about, you know, this is right, this is wrong, we messed this up, that having people have a little bit of distance come in and talk to us is good. You know, for the last 30 years or so, I've gotten to be friends with Warren Buffett, and he's in Omaha. He's not in this tech world at all, you know, and to him it's like, hey, how could you ever know which will rise and which will fall? I'm not going to put money until Apple sold at a multiple of 12. Then he decided he could put $50 billion into that. After he asked all his friends, hey, you know, if somebody had an iPhone that was half as expensive, would you switch away, you know, or is it more like jewelry where you really want to have an iPhone? And so he decided that those profit streams might not be eliminated anytime soon. Anyway, because he's not in this world, he has a definite way of looking at things, including this idea of how work should be fun. He has made his work so much fun that he works more hours than I do. He works 6 days a week at 88 years old. And he likes to say that he skips to work every day. He doesn't, but he says that. When he was 83, he could still skip, but now he's gotten really, he can't do it. Having somebody like that, you know, the toughest thing I went through was this antitrust lawsuit where, you know, it didn't seem very predictable. And he was a great counsel during all of that stuff. So getting somebody who's successful in another domain, but yet kind of a business type mindset. Anyway, for me, that was a huge gift.
I do think that if you want to talk about software innovation, that at least listening to the ideas of people who've been successful in that area isn't such a bad thing. I mean, you literally say that we can't talk to politicians if you really think that sharing our opinions about, say, climate change or malaria or malnutrition or charter schools, you know, if that's really bad, you know, this group does have more free time. They have proven that, you know, they're energetic, can solve some things. And often they get into a phase of their life, like Steve Schwartzman is putting a lot of his energy and thought into very creative and I think what will be positively impactful philanthropy.
There are probably a lot of people who can run Microsoft and do a reasonable job. When I was growing up, Bill Gates was my hero.
Oh, come on.
Yes.
He's like Darth Vader. He's not Luke Skywalker. No. He's the bad guy.
No, he is not. Bill Gates ran one of the most mission-driven companies that I can think of. Right, and you know, right now I think Microsoft, their mission is less focused than it used to be. But when I was thinking about, you know, what I wanted to be when I grew up, you know, Microsoft, I thought, had a great mission. Put a computer on every desktop and in every office, right? Or maybe it was every desktop in every home. You know, I mean, there are companies that define themselves by a way of doing things, right? I mean, there's like the HP way that I was talking about, and there are companies that define themselves by making a concrete change in the world. And, you know, Microsoft did that. And I have a huge amount of respect for him for doing that. And he pushed them, and it was an incredibly inspiring company during the time that he was doing that. I think that they still are doing a lot of things, but I think that they've lost some of the focus. And I don't know. I mean, I think he's like one of the greatest visionaries that our industry has ever had.
I always kind of like
I get a little upset whenever any media attention focuses on me personally and me leading Facebook, much less a movie.
it's been kind of a bad year, hasn't it?
It turned out okay.
Time Academy.
It turned out okay. The time thing was awesome. That was really flattering. But I think that it's one of these things that the media systematically gets wrong, is that this idea that it's a person, right? It's never a person, right? It's always a team. And the most important thing if you are an entrepreneur trying to build something is you need to build a really good team. And that's what I spend a lot of my time on, right? I mean, I spend probably at least 3 hours a day with our core team, right, and doing things. I spend probably 25% of my time recruiting, finding good people, both outside the company and inside the company, to put in more in more impactful roles.
I'm Sergey Brin. I'm from Google, and prior to that, I was a PhD student at Stanford. Larry and I first met when he came to visit during the PhD recruitment weekend, which was he started a couple of years after I did. And we became good friends when he actually agreed to join and came on board. And we experimented with a variety of things. You know, we had some shared interests, and Larry had this crazy idea that he was gonna download all the links on the web and then do something with them. It wasn't entirely clear what. We did find that there were great applications, and one of them was search. Which eventually became Google.
Co-founders are super important for building a company, and you guys have doing great for 15 years. Have you sort of like fundamentally disagreed on something at all over the last 15 years, and how did you resolve?
Where do I start? No.
I think if you get to know somebody over a long period of time, we're working together for so long, and we, you know, are committed to doing that, you don't like get agitated about one little thing or the other. I don't know, we work it through. And also generally we've gotten to think remarkably alike, which scares some people around us, I guess.
Yeah, and the other thing, I mean, we know enough, I guess, that when we're disagreeing, I mean, you make a lot of calls that aren't obvious. So, I mean, if you're disagreeing, it's probably that it's not obvious what to do.
Is part of the interviewing process, do you have essentially a culture check?
Like but not like a checklist. Mm-hmm. Culture is always something that we interview for, of kind of curiosity. And it's easy to find people who say, oh, I read the Netflix culture deck. I love it. I really want to be there. You know, what's harder is, well, you know, what are the main things you disagree with and why? Uh-huh. You know, and when we get a blank stare, we're like, okay, not really a first principle thinker. And when they say, well, I thought the way that you didn't talk about how to acculturate, and, you know, if I'm not great on day three, am I out, you know, or is there... do you look at it like an athlete where it's over some, you know, time period to prove yourself? And if so, what's that time period and why haven't you clarified that? Then we're like, oh yeah, that's a good insight. First principle thinker. So we're looking for people who, you know, are curious, typically self-confident, and they're not, they're questioning everything around them.
If you're going to politics, you should go to DC. If you go into finance, New York, movies probably still LA. Yeah. And tech is Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley has an aspect that's very open, very fluid, and it helps tremendously on these cutting edge ideas. You want to be in the place where you can talk to as many people as possible about your ideas, because that's the way you will know that they're cutting edge and you will improve them even more.
I made the mistake in my life of studying people that appeared to be successful.
A lot of people are like that.
They appeared to be successful. You know, today in the times that we live in, you know, you can go on Instagram and it looks like everybody owns a Ferrari, everybody has a Rolls Royce, everybody looks like they're having the best day of their life. That's not studying, that's watching. I want to study people. Or even at conferences, you can go to a conference and watch somebody on stage and he or she could present to like they're so successful, but if you really get behind the scenes, you'll find out there is no success there. It's just a lot of talking. And so I would just strongly suggest to people to pick a handful of people and make sure those people are actually doing, not just saying. You know, that they're not talking about success. They're actually doing success every day.
And how would you know what they're doing?
Well, you would see it in their statistics, right? Like, there's some things you can't fake.
Yeah.
You can't fake somebody. We're buying $250 million worth of real estate this month with my money. Hard to fake that. Okay. It's a great Instagram post, by the way, but you can't fake it. There's going to be a loan. There's going to be a building. There's going to be, you know, acres and acres of land. There's going to be people living there. Like, you just can't fake it. So there's a lot of things you can fake. You can make a nice little quote, put it on Instagram. People look at it like that's the truth, you know? And the public is confused with a lot of what appears to be the truth that's not.
True.
And so I would just tell people, study people that have success, that are doing it now. Also, the second thing I would say is make sure that where you're getting your advice from them lines up with where you need advice. Right. So Warren Buffett, he's at the tail. He's at the tail of his. He's probably here. Right. So here he was doing different things than he's doing here. He talks about investing in stocks, but he actually doesn't do it. He doesn't buy stocks. He buys companies.
Yeah.
So you got to listen to people. Steve Jobs right here was one of the most aggressive business people that this planet's ever seen. I mean, he was barbarian aggressive. So was Bill Gates. But if you talk to Bill Gates today, Bill and Steve's not alive, obviously, but Bill Gates today saying, dude, I'm giving all my money away. Money doesn't matter. That's not what he was saying right here. 25 years ago, I had...
and his hunger for power became known to more and more people. The demands to do something about this outrageous man became louder and louder.
Controlling your breathing right now, in this moment. Here, in the present, the greatest gift you have, that we have, that power, that determination that's in you and everyone. Same power we use to control our minds, one thought at a time, one breath at a time. Here we are, another beautiful day in the gym of life. Life, the greatest teacher of all. You get to learn from it every single day, every single moment. No matter how young you are, how old you are, no matter what you look like, how different you are, we are one. We are the same in one fundamental way. One truthful way. We were born to win. To be happy, to be as we were born. So let's see ourselves today. Determination, let's see ourselves determining to do our best on whatever exercises, stretches we do, the way we move our bodies today in this moment we have together, do it to the best of our ability. By simply being.
Ready to start our warm-up? We're going to start off by just walking on the spot. Okay, start getting your arms involved. A little bit higher with our knees. you had some room, you can walk a few steps forward, a few steps back. Now we're just gonna go with high knees. Try to get opposite knee, opposite arm. Now we're gonna go to heel kicks. Try to get your heel as high as you can towards your backside. We're gonna do some side shuffles. Just gonna go off a few steps to your side. See how much room you have. You might have preferred for two shuffles, possibly three shuffles. And now we're gonna do some leg swings. You have a wall, you can hold on to your wall. Work both sides. We're going to move to some hamstring stretches as we move. So you're just going to go down, try to touch heel to the floor, try to get as low as you can. You don't need to touch the ground. Just sweeping the floor with your arms. Going heel to toe, heel to toe, heel to toe. Awesome. Some big arm circles forward. A little bit smaller. And smaller. Now we can go reverse. A little bit larger, larger, and nice and big circles. Awesome. Should be ready for our workout now that we're nice and warmed up. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was a great workout. Now it's time for a cool down. Let's start off with a few cool down stretches. Start off with the shoulder stretch. Take your right arm, place it across your body. You can use your left arm to pull it towards your body gently. Let's switch with your left arm. Next, we're going to try an overhead stretch. Arms together, just reach up for the sky. Then we're going to do hands behind your back, stick out your chest. We're just going to do a chest stretch. Awesome. We're going to go down to the floor in a kneeling position. Start off with my right knee back, left knee forward. And all I'm going to do is a hip flexor, and I'm going to move forward, keeping your body nice and straight. Move forward. And hold. And switch. Remain straight and lean. Your front foot is flat on the floor. Next one, we're going to go onto our stomachs. On your elbows, elbows are directly under your shoulders. And we're just going to come up like a cobra. We're going to turn over onto our backs. Arms out. We're going to start off with our right leg, trying to touch our left hand, but keeping our right shoulder onto the ground. And let gravity do the work. Bring it back and try left foot, trying to touch our right hand. Keeping both shoulders onto the floor. And back up. Last one, we're gonna do a hamstring stretch. This one, I need you to have your knees slightly bent, feet shoulder width apart. We're gonna keep our back straight on this, and we're gonna try and get as far down as we can. Some of you will be able to touch your toes. What I don't want you to do is have your legs straight and do this. What you want to do is slight bend, keep your back straight, and see how far down you can go and hold. Great, great job today.
I just knew that it's what.
As we always begin.
as everything begins. Through the power of our minds, controlling our breathing. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, if you're here, in this moment, in the present, using your gift, the greatest gift you have, the now, I love you. I love you because we're all one. We can all stay in the present and be our true presence. Be the human being we were all born to be. Our best today, this gym period, is the way we can do our best in everything and anything, including remaining deeply grateful and loving and kind to each other, helping each other learn, grow, helping each other win together. There's no greater joy than that. There's no greater happiness than that. That's the ultimate truth. You can feel it right now. You were born to win, to be happy, to be peaceful, to simply be your true great self, to enjoy fully this moment right now. So much, everyone. Have a great day, a great week, and always a great life. Enjoy all those around you. Be peaceful, kind, loving, and caring. Help each other win all the time. Love you. Until the next time. We'll see you next time.
Hey everyone, and welcome to Top Think. Today we're going to learn about 7 simple habits that'll make you smarter. Now, let's begin. Number 1, doing nothing. Do you set aside time to do nothing? You may have a long list of responsibilities on your plate. You spend hours every day working, running errands, keeping up with your hobbies. You want to develop productive habits to increase your work ethic and use your time wisely. You do all these things to improve yourself. But what if I told you one of the best ways to increase your intelligence is to do nothing at all? When you're running around all day, every day, you rarely get a minute to yourself. When you're finally alone, you're so exhausted that you feel like turning off your brain. So you watch TV, you play games, and you enjoy popular time wasters because you want to give your brain a break from the chaos of your daily life. But you don't have to waste your time to relax your brain. You can unwind after a long day while simultaneously boosting your brain power. All you have to do is sit down, tune out the world, and think.
One of the great challenges in this world is knowing enough about a subject to think you're right.
You might think about your goals. You might think about your loved ones. You might think about the happiest parts of your day, or maybe the most frustrating. There are no requirements and no expectations. There are no lists, schedules, or time limits. You can think about everything, or you can think about nothing. The only requirement is that you think all by yourself. Now, during the time you spend thinking, you may discover a strange kind of clarity. When you're busy, your thoughts are muddled and scattered. You're thinking every which way, and you can hardly make sense of your own thoughts. All you know is that you're stressed and confused. But when you stop to think in a quiet place, you can unravel and digest your most overwhelming problems. That's where this simple habit comes in handy. It doesn't boost your IQ or reveal the mysteries of the universe, but it does teach you how to think and solve problems on your own. That kind of intelligence is invaluable. Number 2. Arguing against yourself. You can argue in favor of ideas and values that you believe in, but how often do you argue against your own opinions? Here's a challenging intellectual exercise that works your brain in unique ways. So the next time you argue a point, change sides. Yeah, change sides. Argue the opposite of what you believe. This is called playing devil's advocate, and it's an incredible exercise to strengthen your intellect and your personal opinions. Why? Well, because arguing against yourself helps you recognize the holes in your opinions. It challenges you to think harder about your ideas. But most of all, it helps you understand both sides of a controversial subject. So when you play devil's advocate, you're forced to recognize the possibility of something else, an opinion that isn't your own. Many people are so focused on being right that they don't think through the stances they take. They blindly believe that their way is the only way, but that's rarely the case. The most intelligent people know that every argument is more complicated than simple rights and wrongs. Every difficult question demands a broad spectrum of answers, but it takes an open mind and a strong intellect to understand multiple perspectives. So challenge your opinions, get to know all sides of an argument, and recognize the holes in your thinking. Your opinions may change or stay exactly the same. Either way, by expanding your perspective, you've gained a deeper understanding of a complicated issue. Number 3. Reading every day. Reading finds its way into many of our videos. It's one of the most versatile and constructive habits out there. It can be fun, relaxing, educational, and challenging. Reading can open new doors, help you navigate difficult situations, and ignite passions that you never knew existed. Above all, daily reading gives a significant boost to your intelligence. For starters, reading activates your imagination. Your imagination is your ability to create new ideas and concepts. There's a gross misconception that artists are the only people with strong imaginations. That couldn't be further from the truth. Almost every significant person in history had a powerful imagination. From writers to scientists, these imaginative people were resourceful, clever, and perceptive. Their imaginations empowered their brain with a flexible array of mental tools, and it can do the same thing for you. So, if you're looking to boost your intelligence, then your imagination's a great place to start. Whether you want to be witty or wise, adaptable or perceptive, every intellectual benefits from a fine-tuned imagination, and the best way to develop your imagination is reading every day. Number 4. Available resources. In the world today, there are limitless options for anyone hoping to expand their brain. All you have to do is look. Countless podcasts, videos, and seminars exist online to educate you on a wide variety of subjects. You can learn about the arts, investigate the sciences, or engage with hobbies that you've never even heard of. The problem is, these resources aren't always standing in plain sight. Most people won't go out of their way to search for a new podcast or seminar. And even if you do, you might listen once and then never tune in again. If you don't engage with online resources, then you're not going to learn much of anything. Learning relies on repetition. You absorb information on a given subject time and time again. Sometimes you hear things you've heard before, other times you hear clashing opinions and disjointed arguments. But all of that information comes together to form your mastery of the subject. So if you want to learn something new or grow your intelligence, then find a resource that works for you. Pick a subject and explore the podcasts or YouTube channel with interesting things to say. When you've found someone you like, incorporate that educational resource into your daily routine. And if you're consistent, you can grow your knowledge in no time. Number 5. Empowering conversations. Reading and studying are effective ways to boost your intelligence, but you can reap the same rewards from one great conversation. All right, let's say you and your friend have a long discussion about a difficult topic. You explain your thoughts, you dissect your arguments, you ask good questions, and by the end of your conversation, you've developed a fuller understanding of what you're talking about. You may not be leading experts in the field, you might not be reinventing your craft, but by challenging your brain, you've nurtured your intelligence in a unique way. Great conversations put your creativity and imagination to the test. When you actively explore topics out loud, you're challenging yourself to use your knowledge. You get a clearer idea of what you know and what you don't. If you've found yourself a capable sparring partner, the two of you can push each other to new intellectual heights. So find someone whose intelligence you admire and start up an interesting conversation. Talk about something that lights a fire inside you, because a great conversation can change the way you think.
Do you want to make $1,000 today and then $1,000 a day, every day? You will only...
Number 6. Daily brainstorming. Do you spend time brainstorming? Brainstorming plays a role in many professional fields, but it's also a valuable practice to increase your intelligence. Just try this. For 15 minutes, sit down at your desk, open a notebook, grab a pencil, and pick a topic that you want to brainstorm about. Are you interested in rewriting your goals? Do you want to move your career in a new direction? Maybe you're an artist hoping to generate ideas for your next work. Whatever topic you choose, write down 10 ideas, the first 10 that pop into your head. They don't have to be life-changing ideas. You might not like everything you write down, but that's okay. Every once in a while, you might stumble upon a kernel of wisdom, but your brain benefits from generating new ideas, whether they're useful or not. This daily habit teaches you to think outside the box. You hone your ability to innovate, adapt, and create on the fly. Like a strong imagination, this is one of the most important tools an intelligent person can have. It's useful in any line of work, and it only takes 15 minutes a day. So brainstorm first thing in the morning. Pour yourself a cup of coffee, find a quiet corner to think, and write down 10 new ideas. Not only are you warming up your brain for a productive day, but you're also boosting your creative power. Number 7. Intellectual influence. Intelligent people surround themselves with intellectual equals. They want stimulating and challenging conversations, so they choose friends, partners, and professional connections that force them to expand their minds. Not every single one of your friends needs to be a brainiac. With some friends, it's easier to turn your brain off and relax, knowing they don't have any expectations of you. However, if you want to grow your intelligence, then you can't spend all your time with people who aren't interested in difficult subjects. Expand your social circle to include people at or above your intellectual level. Ideally, you should look for people who've achieved the kind of success that you're looking for, because these are the people you can learn from. But why is it so important to make intellectual friends? Well, you gain a kind of secondhand intelligence by spending time with someone who's highly intellectual. Intelligent people use more challenging vocabulary, they engage in harder conversations, and they ask better questions. They even make more sophisticated jokes. So when you spend time with intellectual friends, their natural intellectual rubs off on you, and that raises your intellectual standards. So find a new group of intellectual friends. No, you don't need to get rid of your old ones, but you do need people in your life that challenge you, that argue with you, and encourage you to improve. Hey, thanks for watching Top Think, and be sure to subscribe because more incredible content is on the way. Thank you.
Your son is a failure. He's barely passing my class, and with grades like this, I'm just not sure what kind of future he's gonna have. What do you have to say for yourself? You're supposed to graduate this year.
Listen to Mr. Johnson. What kind of future do you think you're gonna have?
With all due respect, don't call me a failure. Failure is an event, not a person, in fact. And you talk about the future, Mr. Johnson, but you're not preparing us for that.
Excuse me?
Just listen to what I'm saying.
This should be good.
Would you agree that in the future, most careers will become automated?
Yeah, so?
So the people who succeed will have to be curious, innovative, with resilience to adapt to new changes.
What's your point?
My point is, the focus in this school is not on that. It is on regurgitating information and test taking, and that's just real. But in today's world, creativity is the most important leadership skill.
Oh, that's how you feel.
You don't have to believe me, but maybe you will believe the 1,500 executives who recently said creativity is the most important leadership skill. See, pretty soon, no one will be hired because of what they know. Because who cares what you know or if you've memorized a fact? We've got Google and Siri for that. In the future, people will be hired because of what they can do with their knowledge. Can they creatively solve real-world problems, not just follow instructions or directions and bubble in multiple-choice questions? So, Mom, that's why I'm stressed, because these robotic tasks we learn in school should stop. Because no one can do a robot's job better than a robot. Billionaire founder of Alibaba, Jack Ma, said that we should not compete with artificial intelligence, but instead focus on developing unique human intelligence. Mr. Johnson, drills are for teeth, not the human mind. So these repetitive knowledge-based tasks we must leave behind. Or in the future, you're gonna find a lot of people graduating out of your class right into the unemployment line. See, many top companies today don't look at grades. Mom, that old way is expiring. Google has been quoted as saying GPAs are worthless criteria for hiring. Founder of Tesla, Elon Musk, agrees. So I say this with unease and sorrow. If you continue to teach today as you taught yesterday, then you rob us students of tomorrow. Mr. Johnson, I'm gonna keep it real with you. Sometimes sitting in your class is tough. I'm constantly thinking, if I don't look up at the clock, maybe it'll speed up. So I listen to you do my work and pay attention, feeling like an hour had to have gone by, but it was only 3 minutes. So if you wonder why we're bored in class, look, you want to get a kid to hate reading? Give them this, a school textbook. And some people think it's our fault, and that hurts me. They say you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. And to that I say no. Firstly, you can put salt in that horse's hay and make him thirsty. And if you bring joy in your classroom, you can make any bad student nerdy as he or she discovers the beauty of truly learning. Mr. Johnson, I mean no disrespect. You have the most important job on this planet. You build, create, and save lives. But if you really care about my future, like you say, then you have to fully commit and ask yourself honestly, how do I prepare a child for a future that doesn't yet exist? Here's a hint. The answer is not found in this. It's using this and this. See, in the future, we will need more passion and compassion. People with inspired hearts and wisdom to uplift this planet. And Mom, I love you, but can I be real?
Go ahead.
You want to know one of the biggest factors for childhood success? It's not IQ. It's family meals. And we haven't had one of those in a while. See, I know sometimes you don't feel proud, because I may not be a straight A student, but I'm not stupid. These tests may be 70% of my grade, but they're 0% of my future. But don't worry, I'll pass this class and get through this. But I need you to give me the space I need to be me and live true. Because the best feeling in the world is that your own parents get you. There's a passage in a book called The Prophet by Khalil Gibran. And if you don't mind, I'd love to share it with you.
Go ahead.
See, he says, your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, they do not belong to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts. For they have their own thoughts, You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow. So, Mom, I'd appreciate it if you give me the love that I need to pursue my dreams. See, if we are to succeed, all three of us need behavior change on all fronts. We talk about the future, but the future is now, and it is created now by all of us.
I've never heard you speak like that before.
Yeah, I didn't know.
But I'm going to reach out to administration and try to change some things. You have my word.
Thank you.